Oscar, I trust I find everybody in a great frame of mind, as we all should be right now, right? Why not? Well, we can probably think of a million reasons why not. Yeah, and yet none of those really matter that much. Now, here is what is happening. Transmissions received, which have simplified everything for me. And this is what happens on the path. So you have to trust the path, in that you reach a point where the simplifications happen, and you realize how simple it is. And yet you cannot really, at that point, you can't really explain it, because any explanation makes it more complicated than it actually is, and creates a conflict in the mind of the one listening. They say, well, you're simple, and yet your explanation is not simple. Well, words are never convey the simplicity of truth. They cannot. Words have no intrinsic meaning to themselves at all, actually. And so they're inherently complex. Ambiguous. Ambiguity, it breeds complexity, does it not? So you have to trust your path. You have to trust your path. Ultimately, one insight settles it all. One simple little insight settles everything for you. So this will arise within you. All of the insights, the clarifications, what they do, it becomes simpler and simpler and simpler and simpler and simpler. And you say, oh, that's so easy. And just let it be. Don't try to explain it. Don't try to explain it, really. That just obscures it, actually. It obscures it. So you have to be very careful. We can talk a little bit here and there about this and about that, but the discipline you need is to trust your path, trust your practicing, and as you practice, full stop on the wow, evaporate your continuity fear, these clarifications arise within us. Could be a transmission from one of our Dharma kings. And you just say, aha. And now you know. Now you know. Now you know how it is. It's like that. But trying to explain it to someone? No. No, that never will work. It will not work. Because those who demand explanation are in a hurry. Too much of a hurry. And they don't trust the path. And they think that they can get it with words and concepts and stuff. And no, you cannot. You have to trust the path. So I trust my teachers, I trust the path. I appeal to them for clarity, and it arrives. This is what how everyone should feel. Trust your teachers, trust the path, trust your practice. And trust that truth is intrinsic within all of us, and it will just clarify, it'll become simple. You simply see it, say, oh. Okay, so now I see it. Just keep evaporating your continuity fear. That's all you can do, actually. That's all we need to do. That's all we need to do. The worst drug of all is caffeine, actually. It's the one that most interferes with the spiritual awakening. It keeps interfering with it. And you go into analysis and thinking and explanation and conceptualization instead of just quiet stillness. And you lack the wisdom to handle whatever insights arise. You lack wisdom to know how to properly allow it in your awareness. caffeine is turning everyone into a very robotic nature. It's an insidious drug, very insidious. And again, like I said, over 90% of the world uses caffeine every day. This is why the world is going to hell, actually. If you want to bring the world to a more spiritual condition, ban caffeine. Okay, that would be the most important step you could take. And yet it's the one that nobody in the world will accept, right? Caffeine addicts will not accept it. 90% of the world would completely reject this. It's extremely insidious how it works. It causes some sort of self-absorption of needing to you know, the way it, you can see in the Silicon Valley how it works, and it ultimately you become more fixated and more fixated and more robotic, and thinking that you need to go faster and more efficiently, and you become streamlined in a robotic way. This is what caffeine does to you. And you don't have the 360 degree relaxed flexibility that you need. Caffeine tends to narrow your focus down and then push you in a certain way, right? It's horrible. It's a horrible drug. I avoid it like the plague. Because these breakthroughs and insights, they have to be handled correctly. This is called wisdom. You don't get wisdom from caffeine. You ultimately get what you think, what we think is more effectiveness in functioning in a certain way, but it's a stupid kind of functioning, actually. That's why the world's becoming stupider and stupider. It really is. You think the tech people in Silicon Valley are smart? No, they're very stupid. Incredibly stupid. Very robotic. And yet skilled at being very robotic. But being skilled at something doesn't mean you're wise. You can still be very stupid. It's I call it the Silicon Valley, you know, prison system or detention center. Silicon Valley, it's really a prison. Coming back up from Southern California, coming into Silicon Valley, I felt I was returning to a prison, actually. And I felt as as concerning as the vibe was in Southern California, the materialistic nature, it's way worse here. It's way more scary here in Silicon Valley than LA. And it's really interesting. I'll tell you something. I mentioned to so many people about LA, my experiences there, and I said, yeah, you know. And without exception, everyone I've spoken to in Northern California, they immediately start putting LA down. Like, you know, just cursing it almost. Like, it's like the worst place in the world. They hate it. And I'm saying, wait, whoa. I don't hate it. It's actually better than here. Northern Californians have this extreme entitlement complex. They think they live in the best place in the world, and nothing else can touch it. And especially, they're super hostile to L.A., in their attitudes. They think we're way superior to LA. Way superior. Fact is, we're worse than LA. Northern California is worse than Southern California. And nobody here will admit this. Nobody. I might be the only person, Northern Californian, who says, I believe that Southern California is better than Northern California. It's amazing the prison system that we have here in Northern California. It's a prison system. I got to tell you the truth. I live in a prison system. Northern California is a prison state. A prison system. It's a mental prison system. And any idea that you might leave it, you say, you can't leave it, what are you talking about? You're going to hell. Well, I could tell you, I did not encounter a single bad driver down in Los Angeles. And I never have, actually. It's amazing. They're all expert drivers down there. They know how to drive. They're aware. Okay, they're aware, they're focused, they're not narrowed down like robots, like I have to save a nanosecond so I can't let you in. They see, okay, everybody's merging for a freeway. We're gonna let them in. Everybody lets each other in. It's beautiful the way they drive down there. It's like a paradise for driving. And you tell that to Northern California, they think you're completely insane. They say, "What? L.A.? Why?" I've told people, they look at me like I'm crazy. So it's terrible down there. Just atrocious. Have you heard the stories? Oh my God, it's Armageddon down there, traffic. I said, "No, it all flows." They go, "What?" They don't believe me. They do not believe me, and none of them will check it out or be honest about it. It's amazing. And you come up here, Silicon Valley, the traffic is so horrible, and they make excuses. Wow, this was happening, this happened. No, it's horrible here. It's like a miniature. There's no structure. It's overburdened here. It's crazy here. The infrastructure is terrible here in terms of handling the number of cars and people, and it's going to get, doubly worse soon because of all the massive apartment building complexes that are going on, with no freeway building at all. This place is horrible, Northern California, truly horrible, the Bay Area. And yet people here are like, it's a cult. It's really a cult. The prison system cult in Northern California. And every time I leave, go down to Southern California, I come back up. I feel it. I feel it's like this is hideous. I got to get out of this place. This place is terrible. And yet they all think they live in, in paradise, Shambhala or something. What a cult it is here. And it's it. And they cast, disparage any other place, so that anyone who leaves, you must be crazy. That's a cult, isn't it? Yeah, it's a massive tech cult we have here in Northern California. It's a cult place, very much so. I'm very aware of this. And I said, man, I got to get out of this cult. Help me, Padmasambhava. Help me, Jesus Christ. Jesus Christ, Ananda Maima, Jamyang Ramana, Longchenpa. Help me get free of this cult. Northern California is a cult. And there's nobody up here saying that. Nobody. Except right here. Basically. Now, this is not to say that LA isn't this kind of a cult also. it's not paradise by any means. But it's certainly quite different and not this, terrible place that people think it is. And people in LA, everybody thinks they're happy that they found the good life. It's a bunch of Minnesotans basically thinking they found paradise, and they think that they live in the best place in the world. It's like paradise down here. It's like, so it's the world's weird place, right? And yeah, take it easy. Come on, everything. Come on over and let's swim. Let's have a pool party. Let's have some, lots of good food and relax and laugh and chat and be happy and convivial. It's very convivial, conviviality. Everybody's just, they're happy and like, okay. Very bizarre, California. Very bizarre. But boy, is the North on an entitlement trip. They are really tripping in a cult-like way up here. Hideous place. I call it the prison. It's a prison. It's a prison. Very bad prison here. Like a cult, everyone thinks they're totally happy here. Nobody could possibly want to leave here. It's impossible. We all love being here, It's like that. There's nowhere else we could possibly be. I come back and I go into the first place I go into is Whole Foods. I never go into Whole Foods, but I had to get some. Someone requested a specific food, and they liked it there, so I had to go in there. And it's like, whoa! You talk about like jumping into ice water or something. From coming from Southern California into Northern California Whole Foods store, it's like, did I just enter like some sort of alternative reality or something? I think I did, actually. Wow. I thought I entered some sort of cartoon, alternative reality of cartoon characters or something. What in the world? kind of shredded my mind almost. It was so weird. So, this brings us to the wonderful Wowchella conference. You heard of Coachella, Coachella, C-O-A-C-H-E-L-L-A, Coachella, Coachella, music festival in the Coachella Valley of California, based on Palm Springs and then that south from there, that area, is Coachella. It's a music festival, and I call it Wowchella because we went down to that area for a spiritual convention. And so that was quite an experience, to say the least. You know, maybe I was the most bumbling, fumbling delegate of all, but I was still there, and I experienced it, right? So that's big time in the world right there, big time in the world. And the insights and transmissions were so profound that, you know, it's difficult to explain them. It's difficult because they're so simple and profound. And to me, you know, it's like I experienced it. So it's like, I get it. That's part of the benefit of attending this kind of subtle spiritual convention and hanging out with the Dharma Kings, etc. One of the benefits is you get these transmissions where suddenly everything simplifies for you. But it's difficult to get otherwise, really. Because you're still thinking. Well, when you're thinking, you're insane. That's what insanity does. It thinks. It doesn't really recognize. And we all, you know, have been there and done that, right? Thinking. So don't think. Easy to say, but just don't think. So the transmissions did occur. And more to the point, pragmatically, practically for everyone, transmissions about what's going to happen in this world were very strong. Very, 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 very strong. And it was made very clear to me that trouble is on its way. Trouble is on its way. As you would expect in this world, the way that it's going. The trends, it's just pretty astounding what the trends are. And it's sort of like a train wreck happening in front of everyone's eyes. It's just like, here comes the train wreck. You know, wow. Yeah. And we just have not been generating bodhicitta in the world for the last 60 years, very much, okay? It's basically been, we've strayed from what is bodhicitta, what is merit, what is grace, what do they talk about? It really means familiarity with truth to the point where we start practicing. You can't start practicing until you really have a lot of trust and familiarity in the path. That's why very few actually practice. Very few do. And that's why very few really succeed, because you need to practice in order to succeed. Practice evaporating, meaning evaporate your continuity fear. So very few do that. Most just think, instead of a full stop in the wowing, full stop in the wow. Actually doing it. But you have to trust your teachers and trust your path in order to do that. Trust the truth that it's there. And then you're patient enough to allow the continuity fear to evaporate. And then you make really great progress. You have to generate, Buddhism calls bodhicitta, Hinduism, bodhicitta. Accumulate this familiarity. And you know, some have managed to accumulate some. I've had to work at it, nonstop my whole life, so I've been able to get quite a bit, enough so I can practice effectively. But you have to really dedicate yourself to it. this world, one way to put it is you could say, and not just this world, but all realms, any realm that you're born into is a delusionary realm, a mental projection of your imagination designed to defamiliarize ourselves with reality. The some of the Dharma kings are not born into this world, they just appear and they disappear. That's actually the right way to do it. You know, that's the civilized way to do it. Any realm you're born into, you gotta believe that's the purpose of that realm is to defamiliarize yourself with reality. So all of these realms that we transmigrate through, and we don't die so much, we transmigrate. The body does die in order to give the illusion that the next realm is somehow separate from the other one, which gives the illusion that thoughts can separate from their source, that ideas can separate from the one having the idea, which is, you know, our belief in separation, which is not possible. So having bodies gives this illusion that you have to die in order to get into this next realm and then have a new body in this next realm. It makes it seem like the realms are separate, but they're not. They're all come from the same mind, you know, same mind. They're all in the same mind. Just like a lotus flower has 1,000 petals. All the petals come from that same lotus flower. They're all part of the base extending itself as petals. But don't try to figure this out. You see it in a glimpse, just a flash. You suddenly see it all. Transmigration is what takes place, and we just wander through realm after realm after realm after realm, circling around and just aimlessly getting nowhere, actually, because we're not these bodies at all. It's all a dream. But this is something that has to be seen, glimpsed, and just poof, you see it. Transmission, like which I received from requesting from Padmasambhava. So Padmasambhava just appeared here as an 8-year-old boy. Okay, now something very interesting occurred to me today, and I realized, oh my gosh, Jesus Christ also just appeared here as a young boy, and they had to make up a backstory for it. Okay. That's how I see it happening. Now, the Jews, of course, are maybe the world's greatest storytellers. I mean, you can't really believe anything they say in terms of, because they're so inventive with storytelling, and they take license with it. It's an art form and not a science. So they may have made up all sorts of stories about Jesus, actually. But my belief is that Jesus simply appeared here in the world. Didn't have any mother or father, just like Padmasambhava. And because Jesus certainly disappeared in the same way Padmasambhava disappeared. He just turned into light. On the Mount of Ascension, he just turned into light. He had eyewitnesses there that saw it. Just like Padmasambhava had eyewitnesses, he just simply turned into light. He wasn't sick, he wasn't dying, he wasn't anything. He just turned into light, disappeared as beautiful patterns of light, very sublimely beautiful. Just like that, you know. I mean, it took a while, I guess, but... there's a number of throughout history, maybe, you know, Adi Shankar just appeared as a young boy, and then he disappeared. Chaitanya may have just appeared and then disappeared. There's throughout history, you have these stories like Krishna, you know, various stories about these great avatars that they have, you know, virgin birth, they're trying to explain away just the appearance, but trying to put it in some body context of like, well, you know, the Christianity says, no, he had to, the Holy Spirit, you know, impregnated the Virgin Mary, and then Joseph found out they wanted to divorce her, but then he decided, no, okay, and then they had the baby in this manger. The whole story, none of it really rings true, does it, actually? And he said, we got to have faith. Well, it sounds like a Jewish story that they made up. It really does. To try and explain away how someone could just appear here. They say, no, you can't come into this realm unless you're born into this realm. Well, that's delusion. That's delusion. That's arrogance. That's the attempt to believe in separation from God, that ideas can leave their source. the source of ideas. We're an idea in the mind of God, and we're trying to leave the mind of God. We can't. But we've dreamed up all these realms that we transmigrate through by getting bodies, being born into those realms, and this gives the impression of separation, actually. So the idea of someone just appearing here, you know, the Jews would have said, no, we, that doesn't jive with our Old Testament stuff. We got to invent some story to account for it. And then you ended up with dual physicism of Jesus having two natures, because then how can you explain? He had a human mother, but a divine father. And, you know, no, he didn't have a mother. Okay, this kind of, this is like upsetting a Christian. It's like, what? You know, Jesus didn't have any mother, didn't have any parents at all. Just like Padmasambhava didn't have any parents. He just appeared in a lotus floating in a lake, as they like to say, as an 8-year-old boy. Now people say, well, that's a myth. Well, his disappearing as light wasn't a myth. It was witnessed by many, just like Jesus was. So if you could just simply disappear as light, why can't you just appear from light? If you can have a body just dissolve into light, why can't you have light solidify, seemingly solidify into a body? Of course you can. So it's very likely he just appeared. And there's no history whatsoever of Padmasambhava having any parents, none whatsoever. And yet we have this Jesus and all these stories of trying to, in the cult of Mary and all this kind of stuff, they're desperately trying to hide the fact that Jesus just appeared here. Because that really bursts the bubble, doesn't it, of all this transmigration. And what we're trying to do with this transmigration of seemingly wandering through all these realms is that we're trying to defamiliarize ourselves with reality. Keep in mind, the mind cannot sacrifice itself. This is what I've discovered directly. When it tries to, it just experiences mental chaos, but it doesn't die at all. It just feels like, I don't like this. But the mind cannot sacrifice itself. It's impossible. So we cannot separate from reality. The mind cannot separate from itself at all. It's always what it is. So all we can do when we want to try and separate from God is to try to defamiliarize ourselves with reality. That's all we can do. So we have these dreams of all these realms and bodies transmigrating through these realms as our way of defamiliarizing ourselves with reality. This is all we're doing. That's all we're doing with all this stuff, is simply trying to become unfamiliar with reality. That's all we can do. And we just keep working at it and working at it, working at it. We have this mythos that somehow, well, someday it'll be effective. But you know, what is effectiveness when you're talking about simply unfamiliarity with what exists, what's real? Where do you go with that? You know, where's the effectiveness? What does it mean to say it's effective? Well, for how long is it effective? Because the real is still there. You know, I've gotten rid of it. Lack of familiarity doesn't get rid of something at all, does it? So where's the payoff? There isn't any. There isn't any. Which is why we keep transmigrating in different realms and saying, well, I got lessons to learn here. You know, I'm in this realm. Okay, this realm is going to teach me these lessons, which are just defamiliarity with reality is all the lessons teach you. And doesn't get you anywhere, does it really? It's like saying, well, I'm really not familiar with this atmosphere. I'm not familiar with it. Well, guess what? It's still there. I'm not familiar with the sun. Well, it's still there. No, I can't be. I'm not familiar with it. What kind of power does unfamiliarity have? Does it have some sort of power? To say I'm unfamiliar with something means it doesn't exist. I can get rid of it by just saying I'm not familiar with it. This is absurd, isn't it? And this is all we're doing. We're just engaged in this transmigration of absurdity. Thinking that if we just keep wandering in absurdity, that somehow we're going to get some sort of payoff. There's no payoff. There's no payoff. And you start realizing this, hey, I'm not getting the payoff that I thought I'd get. You know, what's going on here? So you don't really die. You decide to transmigrate. You decide, okay, I want to go into another realm now. And then, so you think you have to drop the body in order to do that. You don't have to really drop the body. You don't even need to, you know, ultimately you don't need any bodies at all. We're not bodies actually at all. But you can go to another realm without the body dying, actually. Just turn it into light, and then from light, manifest another body in that realm if you want to. There's no need for death at all, actually. It just helps us believe that all this is working, that we're separate. We can separate cause and effect. And in fact, we're not. All this whole 360-degree, these realms, imagine like a merry-go-round, you know, all these different realms, different horses, different realms, and go round and around and around through these different realms. It's all 360-degree being projected by the mind right this instant, in this instant. It all comes from the exact same source. Like a movie comes from the movie reel. Or the projector goes to the projector, and it's projected out on a screen. You think all these different things are happening in the landscape, but it's all coming from the movie film, isn't it? It's all in the movie film at the same time, isn't it? So as you project out a movie, like a couple hour movie, but if you have this reel of film, aren't all the images already on the film right this instant? Yes, they are. But by projecting it out, frame by frame by frame, in a couple hour movie, you think that somehow time has taken place in the movie. And no, it hasn't. Not really. All the frames are present right now in that reel of film. What frame is not present right now in a reel of film? So we can have this reel, big reel of film, and just be projecting it out. And yet all the imagery is present from the beginning. It's already all there. Caffeine is an ego drug. It gives you an ego boost. That's what it does. It gives you a big ego boost. And so the ego then thinks, oh, I need to grab a hold of this and, you know, do something with this and stream. No, you just sit there and just say, wow. Because you can see it. You intrinsically recognize, yeah, all the frames are there right now. Wow. That's a shocker, isn't it, to look at it that way. So don't try to do anything with that. Just let the shock sink in and be relaxed with it. That's the key. That's the wisdom way. Be patient. Once you feel relaxed enough with that, the next big aha moment will come. And you'll tie it together. And you'll keep tying things all together. Like, wow, aha. Now I see that. Wow, that's easy to see. It's like there's this mountain, and let's say we have pure clarity about this mountain. It's there. We're purely clear about it. And yet we're looking at images of the mountain being obscured by clouds. Let's say there's a picture, an image of a mountain being very much obscured by fog or clouds, foggy cloudiness. Now, actually, is the real mountain obscured at all? Not in the slightest bit. It's still completely clear to us. But we're mistaking the image of a mountain for the real mountain, and we can manipulate the image of the mountain to give us an image of clouds in front of the mountain, and then we can get another image that maybe there's less clouds, another image there's less. And so in this way you can substitute images into ultimately you can be holding an image, looking at an image of a mountain without any clouds, perfectly clear, no clouds there, and this is very close to the actual situation. But the actual situation has always been this way. There's never been any obscuration. Only in imagery can there seem to be obscuration. So we can get imagery that's very clear. And then this helps stabilize us into familiarity with clarity, so we can ultimately then actually experience the clarity. A bug just arrived. Arrival of a bug. Yeah, I don't know where it came from. It came from above. Now, troubles in the world. Maybe the bug said, hey, talk about the troubles in the world a little bit. Yeah. That's no fun, is it? Elect Dzogchenpa president. That's the fun. So let's have fun doing that. I went on this hike today. Brutal. It's the most intense hike I've ever taken in my life by far. Holy cow. I tried it previously and I couldn't do it. I just like had to stop because I was just wiped out. And then my shoes fell apart on the way down. So I got new boots. So I put them on today and said, okay, let's go. Let's see what we can do. And yeah, they work great. So I just kept hiking and hiking and hiking. And ultimately, the whole hike took about 2 hours and 38 minutes. I timed it on my watch. 36 minutes, I think. And, you know, the down part took longer than the uphill part. Very amazing, huh? You have to be very careful going downhill. And that's what really fried my legs, was going downhill, because you have to brake. Every step you're braking and making sure you don't slide. And that's what's hard on the legs. Going up, you know, is easier. But you got to be very careful. Don't go up too far, because then you have to turn around and come back. And that's what did in my legs. I stopped a couple times and I could barely stand up. My legs were shaking so bad and I could hardly keep my balance. Fortunately, I found this this walking staff today. Someone had discarded, and I used that. That helped me stabilize. Otherwise, wow, I was swaying. My legs were just like jello, just fried them. The boots work great right out of the box. They're very good, as advertised. So that was just a super intense workout. I am tired, to say the least. I don't know if I can even walk tomorrow. Kind of doubt it. But I did it. I did it. I really put in this amazing hike. Just you know, going uphill. Just wow. Massive elevation change. I don't know. But I felt tired at the conference. It was so intense. This was a super intense period in history, July 29, 30, and 31st. And I certainly felt out of whack. I was in like great shape. Been working out for a year for this convention. But I felt so weak down there. So weak and unstable. It's like, what? What? And I come back up here today. I'm jumping around, you know, like, let's dance. My legs feel like dynamite. But down there, my body, I was nervous. Didn't feel right, and I felt so weak. Like my legs were just, you know, when something isn't right within you, no matter what great shape you're in, your muscles feel weak, and this is what happened. So it was very, very, very intense. Many, many key transmissions took place at Wild Chella. Wildchella 216, we call it. Wildchella 216. We have a convention now. And again, some of them had to do with this world and what's going to happen. And it's as I expected, really. Confirmation of troubles to come, to say the least. Wow. Middle East, of course, yeah. Big troubles in the Middle East. Very bad dust up coming in terms of the clarity of the world of imagery is going to be severely compromised coming up. And we will feel like we can't do what we want to do in the world. This is the feeling that's coming. It's a feeling that we can't do what we really want to do. Okay? So if you want to know, heads up, this is what is coming. A lot of bloodshed coming. A lot of bloodshed. and just turmoil. You feel like you can't do what you got to do. You may have to leave where you live. You may have to make adjustments on the fly. It is, you know, it's going to be unexpected stuff is coming in the world, to say the least. You have to change your plans for your life. This is what's coming. You have to remain flexible. We had to leave early because of a medical emergency. That was very difficult, but you know, ended up having to do it. And the lesson was, this is what's going to happen in the world. Emergencies will arise in the world, and you have to get at, you know, respond to those, and you won't, you know, your plans for the future, it's not going to go how we think it's going to go. The future is not going to be what people imagine it to be. And so we all have this kind of idea of, okay, I'm going to do this, and suddenly we have to completely change our plans. You know, like, wow, how could I do this? I had trouble. You know, I was pretty upset. Oh, I'm better now, but it was really difficult, because I didn't really get to do, you know, anything as far as recreation or down there and vacation or nothing. But I'd already been warned that it probably wouldn't go that way. So I was kind of okay. So it really, you know, it went the way that I was warned about. Keep in mind that one insight settles it all. So you're not, no one is far away from truth at all. They're only one little insight away from total liberation. Everyone, every one of us. This is a fact. So don't worry about anyone. Don't worry about anyone. That will never change for them, no matter where they transmigrate to. One little insight will settle it all for them. The whole thing of all this wandering about in realms and dying, all this stuff, all regrets and troubles and dismay and concern and confusion, all that just vanishes in an instant. It's all settled in an instant from one super simple insight. And yet simplicity is what we have the most trouble with, because we're trying to defamiliarize ourselves with reality, which means we have specialized in complexity. We've been specializing in complexity. And so we have extremely difficult time with simplicity. We always want to turn it back towards, we have a very difficult time with simplicity. We want to always turn it back towards complexity. Always turn it, because we're so familiar with that complexity. Because it's how we defamiliarize ourselves with reality, which is perfectly simple, actually. So what I did today was I hit the campaign trail. That's how I looked at it. I'm hitting the campaign trail, time for the campaign for Dzogchenpa to be president 2020, to get underway. And I'm calling upon the various aspects of this campaign, the Vice President Padmasambhava, and the campaign advisor, is that Longchenpa or the Chief of Staff? I'm not sure, I can't remember. But so Longchenpa, Jamyang Khenchi Chogyi Lodro, Chandra Sering Chodron, we call upon the Nyingma masters to make good on their promise to appear. Longchenpa promised he would appear. All we have to do is ask him. Before he died, he said, I want to address people of future generations. Okay, so he was addressing us. Before he died, his last talk had to do with addressing us, future generations. Okay, and he said, those of you in future generations, hear what I have to say. I promise you that if you want me to appear to you, I will appear to you. I will appear for you. You need just ask me, and I will do so for you. Well, let's take him at his word and do this then. Let's do this. He said, I can appear in various ways. As a mind transmission, I can appear in dreams, like I've experienced Longchenpa in dreams. Or, he said, I can also appear externally, like a person in the world. I can appear in this way. And he said, I will appear in some way to you if you ask me to. Now, not many in history have said anything like this, actually. I don't know hardly any that have said this. It's really rare. And so that was his, what he was really focused on before he left this realm. He wanted to assure us that he is here. He came here to help us and will continue to help us here. And just because his form isn't apparent to us, our senses, doesn't mean that he's left us, actually. He may have just, maybe in a different realm, or, however we want to put it. He has not left us, and he will appear. Pabasamba also said he will appear. We need but just call upon him. And Longjampa has appeared, and so has Pabasamba. So take him at their word. Let's tell them it's time to appear. It's a campaign. The campaign is underway. I hit the campaign trail. I said, I'm going to climb up this mountain. Yeah, I did so. So, okay, my legs, I can handle it. It's strenuous. But, of course, in campaigns, you have appearances. Now, Dzogchenpa can't appear except as a presence, because Dzogchenpa is formless, undefinable formlessness of true nature of mind. This is our identity. But Pabasamava, being vice president, can certainly appear. Longchampa can appear. Jamyang Kenshi Choke Lodro can appear. Chano Sering Chodron can appear. Nyingma Masters can appear. Dharma Kings can appear. All of these can make appearances to help the campaign to elect Dzogchenpa president of all countries, really. Elect him president of your country, right? Absolutely. Do so. So, expect them to show up. I've already had Chando Sering Chodron and St. Jude appear. I believe that both of those have already appeared in this world. And again, appearing in this world is the civilized way to do it. That's the graceful way to do it. It's the right way to do it. If you're enlightened, you just appear in the world. We don't need you to be born into the world. I don't need that at all, actually. I've never wanted a guru to be born into the world. I said, just appear. But then you could just disappear also. That's reflective of reality, not these births. So when you plug this into Jesus and his life and realize he probably just appeared here as a young boy. And then Mary Jo and Joseph took him in and they covered it all up. And they had everybody in on it, and the stories, the way the stories were written, says, okay, let's come up with this story because what is this, They left Nazareth for Bethlehem, Mary had Jesus, and then they immediately fled to Egypt, disappeared. That's a nice cover story, isn't it? And so when they came back, they had this young boy Jesus with them. But how many people actually saw the infant Jesus in the Holy Land? No, they were gone to Egypt during that time, right? And then the lost years of Jesus. They came back, Jesus just must have just appeared, and the family took him in, so let's give a sense of normalcy to it. And then they went down to Egypt, so nobody would be the wiser. So in Egypt, they just say, yeah, this is our son. Nobody knew him down there. So they say, yeah, this is our 8-year-old son. And nobody would question it at all. But in Judea and Galilee, people would say, what do you mean your 8-year-old son? You didn't have this child. You didn't give birth to this child. That's not your child. What are you talking about? We know you, and we know you weren't pregnant. So the whole story of them leaving and going down to Egypt, like this, Herod, okay, everybody, we're going to kill all the children and stuff like that. Well, it's much more likely it was a way to cover up the fact that they'd taken in this young boy and nobody didn't belong to any family at all. He just had appeared here in this world. Now, that's a great thing that they did. And they must have been, you know, quite very, very advanced, spiritually advanced. You would think so, right? Pavasambhava, what happened with him was the king had just lost his young son, I believe, had just died. And he heard that this young boy, Pavasambhava, had these miraculous, incredible spiritual qualities, and he was very interested in this. And he had the young boy brought to him. And then the king was so enamored of it, he adopted Pavasambhava as his son and said, "You're going to be my heir to the kingdom because you're so extraordinary." So that's how that worked out. Nobody apparently, you know, knew, you know, where he came from. He just said, "I was, you know, appeared here in a lotus flower on a lake." And apparently that was good enough for them. But the propriety of Jewish culture may have required them to make up the story. But Mary and Joseph may have very well gone down to Egypt. Again, nobody down there would be any the wiser that their traveling companion, Jesus, wasn't their son. He had no earthly parents. Just one nature, divine nature. Not dual physicism, monophysicism. So, you know, Christianity has maybe probably covered all this up throughout the years. Unfortunately, they just seemingly they can't handle the notion of just someone appearing here. I don't know why not. I don't have any problem with it. Why can't just some appearance appear here? Why does it have to go through birth? That is ridiculous. Why does it have to go through reproduction cycle for something to show up in this realm? This is all just mental imagery anyway. Why is that all? A concept has to be born of the flesh, really? Or an image, or what? What? That's ridiculous. It's just so ridiculous. If you want to appear, then just appear here. If you want to, Ananda Maima would simply appear in some other realm. She said, "Oh yeah, I just vanished from this realm and appeared in another realm. And then I came back here and reappeared in this realm." Yeah, that's how we should both supposed to do it. Once you see, you know, this is all just a dream. Once you see it, you say, "Of course, you know, it's just like easy to recognize it." So, but don't try to think your way there. Just intuit your way, just hear this and say, "Yeah, wow, this is very, very wowish information, isn't it?" And just full stop in the wow, and just get used to it. How come John didn't know Jesus better? You know, that they're supposed to be like first cousins, right? I never get the impression. I get the impression that when Jesus appeared, John the Baptist didn't even know who he was. He knew there's something foretold to appear, and then the dove descended on him. He said, "Oh, this is the one," or something like that, you know. But if they're first cousins, don't you think he would have known Jesus extremely well? And the lost years of Jesus, where he apparently wasn't even in the Holy Land, and then he just reappeared there when he was, you know, when he was like an adult or something. Yeah, I mean, what, you know, the story doesn't really add up, does it? So Jesus just appeared like as an 8-year-old boy. Mary and Joseph took him in. They went down to Egypt, and then came back later, and then Jesus may have. They may have told people they adopted this son, you know, in Egypt, and people wouldn't have questioned it. Then when they came back to the Holy Land, they could have said that. They could have gone down to Egypt and said, "This is our natural son," and went back to the Holy Land. They could have said, "We adopted this son in Egypt." And Jesus could have also gone someplace else, like Tibet or India or, you know, somewhere, for many years, and then returned to the Holy Land. And then they sort of smoothed out the whole story narrative over time, that kind of thing. So it all fits into the Old Testament, you know, the lineage of David and the Messiah, and they had to sort of all, you know, massage the whole story and make it seem like it was just a continuation of Jewish prophecy and the Old Testament and all this kind of stuff. But if you just have somebody appear here, you know, it doesn't really fit all these, you know, lineages and blood and all blood lineage, all this stuff. It doesn't really work, does it? Doesn't work at all. The, you know, the real guru just appear. Just appear here. And we're, you know, the more robotic we become, the more that terrifies us. So the people of the world are becoming more and more frightened of spirit, real spirituality. As they become more and more caffeinated and then push themselves to be more and more robotic-like. I gotta go faster, you know, so let me be a better machine, that sort of thing. Become terrified of spiritual truth, stuff that doesn't really bother me hardly at all. You know, just, there's a familiarity issue always there, but as far as my mind goes, it's like, yeah. What bothers me is them not appearing. That's what bothers me. I find that very weird. It's astonishing, horrible. What's the matter? Come on, appear. Come on. Pamasaba, appear. That's what you do. I mean, that's what I expect. You're not appearing is very much unexpected to me. It's like that. Cooling off in the Bay Area. Supposed to, the next 15 days, supposed to be like in the 70s. Or you know, yeah, a very cool period. I know it's August. And it's like, what? Now, getting through the troubles that are coming in this world, well, that's important. Trusting the path is super important. Having confidence that one insight settles it all, super important. When you have this belief, you, other stuff, you're able to block everything else out, really. The world doesn't matter. Nothing matters. What's one little simple insight will settle everything for us. Then why are we worried about the world and all this stuff? It's way simpler than that. Just tell yourself one insight settles it all. That's about as powerful a mantra as you could ever possibly say. One insight settles it all. One insight settles it all. So I hope I wasn't too terrible a delegate there. I did my best. And I'm relaying what I can relay. Starting to get a little bit tired because of this intense exercise that I did today. It was just devastating. I really didn't know if I could make it off that mountain. My legs are just fried. I thought I might stumble. I thought I might just, legs would stop working, you know, but they're still attached. Yeah. That's about it. I can tell, I can report they're still attached. I don't know about the other stuff. But as soon as I got back, I had this chocolate protein drink with cherry juice, tart cherry juice, waiting for me. And I just chugged that, and then I had some coconut electrolyte drink and chugged that. You know, to make sure that, you know, the body was getting something that it needed to recover from that. Mostly mountain bikers go up there. Mostly mountain bikers. They're cheating. They got all these gears. Hiking is way more difficult, of course. You see, these guys just robotically, just drink your energy drink, get on your bike, robotically go. It's very robotic to a certain extent. Mountain biking. Mirrors the mentality of this area. People are fanatics here about riding bikes because it really mirrors their mentality. Me, I'm not really interested in riding bikes at this point. I'd rather walk. So don't crave explanations from teachers. Don't crave that. Just trust that you will get every explanation you need will arise for you, and simplify the, your whole outlook will be simplified step by step. It's simplified, 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 simplified. This will happen for you. Trust it. I trust it in you. I don't. I trust it so much. I don't need to explain so much. I know it will happen for you. When you evaporate the continuity fear, automatically it happens for you. There's no way it cannot happen for you. Now, those hiking boots were, I took them right out of the box. I had sized them one time. I just put them on to see how they fit. And then I realized that they have a big toe area, so I needed to wear real thick. I wore two pairs of socks, one really liner and one real thick hiking sock. And then they fit pretty well. But not, I hadn't really walked in them hardly at all. Like, maybe 20, 30 steps or something on that, just to walk around a little bit around here. So they, excuse me, they're like virtually brand new. All right? For all intents and purposes, brand new right out of the box. And I went on this insane hike with them. And, my feet feel fine. They don't need any breaking in at all. And this is what people say. They say, yeah, you don't need to break these boots in at all. They're good to go. And it's true. It's really true. And they worked out fine. Worked out great. Got dirty as heck. But since they're waterproof, I use a scrub brush and clean them all up. But boy, did they get dusty. That's a dusty trail. So I don't, I trust in that everyone has truth within them. So I don't need to put it there. I don't need to put it there. It's already there. I just need to encourage everyone to uncover it. Let it arise by evaporating our continuity fear. Glimpse it a little bit and like, wow, glimpse this a little more. Wow. So what's most important is the practicing. And in order to do that, you do have to, it seemingly you have to generate a certain degree of trust and familiarity and they call it bodhicitta. And so doing that is super important. And there are some in the world who are doing that they, they focus on good habits, as part of the Hindu yoga system is they start out and you have to tame the passions and the body and the habits and a lot of it has to do with a lot of habits and get those right, and this provides a stable foundation for the path. I believe Sri Sri Anandamayi Ma said everyone must do this without exception. You have to. And then once you do that, then you have a strong enough foundation where you're actually able to start practicing. You'll feel the mood of practice come upon you, whereas before it wouldn't come upon you, right? So the only way to practice is for the mood of practice to come upon us, and we just feel in the mood for it, kind of like, yeah, this is what I want to do. But this won't arise for us until we have generated a great deal of familiarity. Wow. Man, I'm tired. What time is it? Oh, it's late, that's why. Okay, maybe that's enough for this video. I need to get to bed and get up and get some sleep. Because that trip just wiped me out. I was so tired. Because of the stress of it all. Very stressful. Very intense. Super important time in world history. That convention was super important. And Coachella was where I could tune into it, perhaps the best. And it was, you know, just seeing, getting this update on the world, and just like, wow, things aren't going to go the way that we expect them to go here. That is for sure. And that's a pretty unnerving, you know, realization, isn't it? So again, I want to show, build up this bodhicitta so ultimately you can get in the mood of practice. Is exercises, it can be part of that, all right? And it's so important to not be robotic. We must like train as if we're going to be big wave surfers, okay? This is what I suggest. I use the example of Laird Hamilton, who's the best big wave surfer in the world, who has ever lived, actually. And you never know what a big wave is going to throw at you. You never know. So if you get robotic in your fitness program, you're going to wipe out on a big wave. You're going to wipe out because your whole body and mind is expecting a certain set of circumstances. This is what you're training for. And then it doesn't show up, and the wave throws something else at you. You panic. You're not ready. You freeze. You freeze. And you can't freeze. You cannot freeze. So you have to, his technique is keep forcing yourself to do different exercises. Keep doing different, don't lock in and fixate on just one sort of exercise. Say, yeah, this is it. Because that's what's going to cause you a problem. Don't fixate. You know, one day you're hiking, the next day you're doing something different, and the next day it's different, and you try this, and you keep sort of inventing new exercises, and don't ever let yourself just fixate. Like going to the gym, yeah, I'm going to sit down and do my bench presses, and that every day you do that. You can't be a big wave surfer if you do that. And there's some very big waves coming in the world. Waves of intense intensity. We have to be able to surf these waves. So part of the training here, I'm like a training coach or something. Spiritual training coach. So I advise, you know, how to do it. And part of that, if physically you're going to, you know, exercise in different modalities, in different ways, in creative ways. It's very important. Do not become robotic. So even on stairs, I go upstairs like sideways. I say, let me try this. Let me try this. Let me do two at a time. Let me run. Let me do three at a time. Let me vary what I'm doing. I looked at other people. I can say, oh, they're varying it. Yeah, don't just plod up and down. Don't become robotic about it. No matter what you're doing, don't become robotic. Don't fixate. If you're walking along, you'll start doing some movement that's different than just walking along. I couldn't dance down the mountain because you'd slip and fall and, you know, twist your ankle. So you had to be a little careful there. And going up, you know, it's you know, you can't really dance your way up so well. So it's a little robotic, but you know, that's okay. But then vary it, do something else that's not so, you know, not different. And martial arts people do the same thing. You know, they don't lift weights so much. They grapple a lot. Because it's the grappling, you never know, you know, what's going to be pulling you, what's going to be pushing you, throwing you. And so you develop this really strong core of being able to respond in all directions 360 degrees. This is the key to really great martial artists. Same thing with big wave surfers. And spiritually, we need to be familiar being able to shift in different directions like this. This whole wild cello thing is a big challenge for people to say, wow, you know, something happened that I didn't expect. I expected it. I knew something was coming up for a long time. So I prepared for it. The Holy Spirit said, you got to prepare. You got to get these transmissions. You got to be able to, you know, help others ride these big waves. There's big waves coming in the world, waves of trouble and bloodshed and lack of clarity. And we have to be able to ride these waves properly. Zogchenpa for president is a great vehicle to do this, actually. Just you could say I'm part of this campaign. I'm active in this campaign to elect Zogchenpa president in 2020. And what you do is you leapfrog over the next 4 years and 4 months. Today's the 1st, August 1st, I think. No, it's the 2nd. Well, it's exactly then four years and 4 months, so November 2nd, 2020 in the United States. Now in your country, of course, this will be different. But using this as an example, the next 4 years and 4 months, you just leapfrog over it all, like I have since about 19, you know, since I had this dream of 9/11 a couple of years in advance. It might have been 1999 when I had this dream and showed me what's going to happen. Since then, I've just been leapfrogging over all this time in history, leapfrogging over all of it, leaping, vaulting over all of this time. So I'm very good at this. Certainly the Bush years, I just managed to sidestep those, and then certainly the Barry years, I've certainly just vaulted over all those last 8 years. Absolutely I have. And so the next 4 years is very important to just vault over those years no matter what happens, and just focus on 2020. And in doing this, it's like the stuff, whatever happens, it's like it's not really happening. It's not really relevant. It's just you feel like you've somehow freed yourself from the time for these 4 years. It's like they never happened. So it's really important to have this flexibility in your perspective of time. And it's like it's already, these 4 years have already been dismissed. We already have our focus on, you know, 2020 and how that's emerging right now. How 2020 is emerging right here, right now. This is what we're focused on. And Dzogchenpa is emerging. Formlessly, definition, freely. Emerging as the presence of present awareness right now. So 2020 is emerging right here, right now. And the other stuff is just, you know, foolish time. That's all it is. So I have a lot of experience in this. My whole life I've kind of been vaulting over time. So time becomes less and less and less and less, seems less and less real to me. Less and less important, less and less real. So we have that, and this is a great way to, you know, to surf the waves and to effectively get through it all. Get through it all. Absolutely it is. I got through 9/11, I got through the tsunamis, various things, because I knew they were coming ahead of time, and I decided I was going to just vault over them, so to speak, and just work on the emergence of, you know, our true nature right here, right now. So there's definitely a way to do it. There really is a way to do it. Alternative focus. 2020 is what's vitally important for us, 4 years from a month from now, and we're getting familiar with 2020 right now. This is the way to put it. See, the 2020 Doug Semper's president, we put it this way. So let's start getting familiar with that. Okay? I do it that way. And so you just vault over what's happening right now. It doesn't have any relevance to you anymore. Because we say Tsok Champa's in 2020, he's already president, or it, Tsok Champa, formless, is already president. And so we're now getting used to this alreadiness. It's already happened. We're getting used to that. See, this is how we can do it. It's a brilliant strategy that the grace of God is helping with. So this other stuff is like it doesn't even, it never happened. It's not even, you know, relevant in the slightest bit. Because whatever they did, Tsok Champa is going to free us from it all. Okay, so it doesn't really matter. Since Tsok Champa is already going to be elected, already president in 2020, and Tsok Champa is going to free us from whatever happened previously entirely, with no trace that ever happened at all, then, you know, we start getting used to that it never did happen, really. It has no relevance to us. We will be completely liberated from it. And since Tsok Champa is going to, like the whole reel of film is already present right now, Tsok Champa is going to be elected 2020, then we're already free of it, right? We're already free of time. The next 4 months, 4 years, we're already free of it. Start, you know, practicing this way. So you can see that, wow, this has got some intense genius behind it, you know, really very, very, very high and effective practicing, isn't it? Yeah, absolutely it is. It's ready to hit midnight. Boy, that's it. I got to wrap this up. And we'll see if I can even walk tomorrow. But I needed to hit the campaign trail hard today because it's now the 4 months, 4 year thing, the 44 thing is now, boom, it has happened here. And so I hit it hard, and you can, and hopefully I can inspire you to do something in your life. It doesn't have to be the same thing I do, but the idea of these videos is to inspire you, give you ideas, sparks of inspiration, like, hey, I can do something similar to that. That sparks me in some way. That's the whole purpose to these videos, to spark you, to inspire you. Don't be a robot. Don't say, okay, how can I robotically follow along? No, be inspired. Be inspired. So, oh, that's a great idea. I like that idea. That gives me something. Idea like this. And you begin to become a, you know, really inspired on the path and very artful and intuitive and able to focus 24/7 on it all. And that's the key, isn't it? Not key, every practice every day. Full stop in the wow. Everyone, full stop in the wow. That's it for this one.